We're going to start off today with the air traffic control perspective of September 11th. And before I introduce our panelists, I'd like to share a few thoughts and kind of set the stage for these people. The job of an air traffic controller is very unique. As a general rule, air traffic controllers like to control, and they like to be in control. Their jobs are very high stress, fast-paced, highly structured, highly regimented. They do everything by the book. Very predictable in terms of what they expect you to do, what they expect to happen, what they expect you to say, and what they're going to say to you. Second thing about air traffic controllers in 2001, their views on hijackings. Hijackings were a thing of the past, pretty much, in 2001. 2001 was a beautiful day, severe clear pilot speak. But air traffic controllers were expecting pretty good day. No big weather systems out there to deal with. So hijackings would have been the last thing on their mind that day. None of the rules that they knew applied. The situation demanded that they improvise. So without further delay, I'd like to introduce to you the panel members. First, I'd like to start with Dan, air traffic controller at Washington National Airport's TRACON facility. Next, Ben Sliney, the National Operations Manager at the FAA National Command Center on 9/11. And Colin Scoggins, air traffic controller at Boston Center and military liaison. Question addressed to all of you, in whatever order you want to. We don't necessarily have to go down the line. On September 11th, it took some time for the airlines and the air traffic facilities and the military to figure out just what was happening. I'd like each of you, how did you figure out what was happening on that day?
Good morning. I was
sorry. Before we get into the first question, sorry about this. Before we get into the first question, because I do want to hear that, why don't you all tell the audience a little bit more about yourselves and what you were doing that day, where you were at, what you expected, and let's set the stage from you all before we answer that one.
Okay. My name is Dan Creedon. On 9/11, I was an air traffic controller at the Washington National TRACON. And I was working at the time the departure sector for every departure out of the capital area going eastbound. Kind of a crazy day, as you know, and I'll get into my experience a little bit later.
My name is Ben Sliney. I was the National Operations Manager on 9/11. That's a position located in the Washington area that actually not talk to any airplanes at all, but we have overarching authority over the nation's airspace, and that was my charge on that day, the safe and efficient operation of the nation's airspace. Colin?
My name's Colin Scoggins. On 9/11, I was assigned to Boston Center. I'm an air traffic controller, but I work in the airspace and procedures office, and I also do the military specialist duties there as assigned as well. On that day, I normally do not work on the operational floor, and I was called down to the operational floor at about 8:30 that morning.
So can we hear from you how you made sense of what was happening and how you learned that it wasn't going to be a nice, severe, clear day?
Well, for me, at Washington National TRACON, at the time was the principal approach controller radar room, radar facility for the nation's capital. When we first heard about it, I've always said that I really feel that people at home watching television had a clearer picture of what was happening than certainly air traffic controllers in my building. It was rush hour. We were really busy. A lot of things going on. And when we first heard an aircraft, we had a problem in New York, and everything going to and through New York was stopped. And then we heard, oh my gosh, an aircraft hit one of the towers. And it was kind of a, well, not quite sure what was going on there. And then we heard a second tower was hit. And I never forget that my heart just sank. I just knew it was going to be a bad day. Well, but for me personally, it wasn't really until we spotted American 77, which ultimately crashed into the Pentagon, about three minutes and 40 seconds out, and when we found out it was an American jet by another pilot who happened to see him, that's when reality hit home for me.
Well, that was my first day in that job as National Operations Manager. And when I got up that morning and looked at the weather channel and I saw the entire East Coast was going to be, as Lynn put it, severe clear, I anticipated that it would be a pretty good day for that first shot at the NOM as the National Operations Manager. And I anticipated nothing but the best. And just to contradict Lynn a little bit, in the command center, we do actually, at my desk, monitor CNN. On the theory that most news of a disaster will be first broadcast by the media, and it's a terrific early warning. So I have CNN on right at my desk, but usually the sound down, but we're monitoring it generally. And at the time when we learned of the hijacking of American 11, and I was about to go to a meeting at around just before 8:30, and the supervisor that I had designated to stand in my place during my absence caught me before I left the room and said that they're reporting a hijacking out of Boston. And I was surprised because I hadn't heard of a hijacking in years. I was familiar with them from years past, but had not really heard of a hijacking. I think the last one was maybe in the 90s, Lufthansa, that actually landed in New York. But and you, my experience with hijackings, and indeed our protocol for hijackings, is one that we cooperate. We get out, every other aircraft out of the hijacked aircraft's way and do everything we can to facilitate the route of flight that the pilot wants. And I didn't think it that urgent, and I left to go to the meeting, and within minutes, the same supervisor came in and told me that we had information that a flight attendant had been stabbed. And of course, I returned to my duties on the floor. While we were trying to locate American 11, on whom we had information had turned south towards the New York area, we were contacting facilities. The military liaison at the command center came up to me and saw on the big screens. In the command center is a room at least this size that has 8 or 10 large screens that we can depict various information, meteorological or air traffic. And he indicated that CNN was reporting that a small plane had struck the World Trade Center. And of course, as soon as we put the screens up, we knew that based on the size of the conflagration that we all feared it was American 11 in the building, but we had no confirmation of that. While that was occurring, New York Center began to develop unspecified difficulties, and we shut down traffic going into the New York area. And as we were standing there discussing it, we actually saw live on CNN United 175 come around and strike the South Tower. And that is a horrible scene, as you all will agree, and I'm sure most of you have seen it in replay, if not live, that day. There are 40 people working in that room, and there was just a collective gasp of horror and dead silence. And that's the point at which at least Ben Sliney and I think most of my staff knew at that time that two things. One, that it was definitely American 11 in the North Tower, and two, that this wasn't the usual, a hijack by some deranged individual wanting to go to Cuba or wanting to release prisoners or some other story, but that this was a concerted action by a group of people and that truly America was under attack.
My day on that morning, normally I come into work about 7:30. It was a gorgeous day up in New England. I came outside, beautiful weather, ended up taking an hour off the front today. Still can't remember what hour, but I came into work actually about 8:25, and someone approached me right at the door and said a hijack was going on. I went upstairs to my office. The last previous hijack we had was Lufthansa in 1993, come through Boston Center's airspace and landed at New York. And all I could remember from the last one is that being as they are, a lot of FAA wanted to go there and get involved with the hijack. And I remember going downstairs then at the time, it was my area, and seeing way too many people around one scope and most people getting in the way. So my intention on that morning was I didn't want to get in the way, so I'd just wait unless someone called me. So I went upstairs to my desk and I actually made a call. Dan Bueno was the supervisor there, asked me to come downstairs and sit at the military desk if I could. And I don't normally sit at that position, but I write all the procedures for it. So I understand the position probably better than anybody else who works the position. And they asked if they wouldn't mind if I sat there. So I sat there and my first trying to find out what was going on at the time. We'd already had reports about American 11. We'd heard about the violence on the aircraft. And it was about 20 miles south of Albany, New York. And it hadn't talked to anybody, and its last clearance was up to 35,000 feet, and he was at 29 feet. And our concern was he's heading down to New York Center, which is one of the busiest centers probably in the world, and we don't know what altitude this guy is. So in addition to trying to comply with what the rules and orders were at the time, which is try to get fighters up just to escort these, there's no mention of all in our rules back then for them intercepting an aircraft. They just get behind it and follow it, which is what they did with the Lufthansa back in 1993. So we're trying to get them on board as well, but the military also, the Northeast Air Defense Command, who I was in contact with that day, my original concern there was find out what his altitude is, and they have altitude finding capability on the same radar that we use, but we don't at our facility. So I wanted to find out if they could tell me what the altitude was, just so I could let New York know this guy's coming through as a hijack, but we have no idea what his altitude is because he turned his transponder off. So that originally was the start, and we knew the aircraft was descending. We watched as we could track a primary radar target on him. We were trying to give that information to the military. They had some antiquated equipment at the time. They couldn't really spot the aircraft. So we knew he was descending based on his ground speed, and he ended up going down into New York's airspace, and we transferred him over to New York. And then we attempted to make a call and talk to New York Center about it, and they told me they were too busy dealing with a hijack. And my assumption then was they were already talking about American 11, so I'll let it be. It turned out they were talking about a United 175, so we had a little lack of communication there. And then American 11 hits the tower, and our first response where we were at was that, well, it couldn't have been American 11, you know, he wouldn't have done that. So we're under the assumption we heard it was a small aircraft or a business jet or something that had hit the tower. And we didn't have CNN up, so we had no idea to look at what the impact was. So our assumption was it was just, you know, some other aircraft. After about 4 or 5 minutes of that, we started talking, and then we started getting some emergency locator transmissions coming from the tower. It happens when an aircraft hits. The ELTs are located on the plane. And then we started questioning in that. And it was about 12 minutes later when United 175 hit. That's when we knew we were under attack.
Okay, a few points based on some of the comments y'all have made. From your comments, Dan, it seems like you weren't even aware that these were airliners that had hit into the towers in New York until 77.
Yeah, the number one underlying theme from a major airport approach control facility like Washington National TRACON was miscommunication. The command center is very busy trying to get a hold of the situation on a national perspective. And we really didn't even know the full gravity of the situation in New York. When we heard both towers were hit, then I knew, once again, oh my gosh, it's a terrorist situation, this is bad. We started initial procedures to shut down our airspace around Washington to VFRs, aircraft that need permission to come into certain pieces of airspace. But not confirmed to us that it was even a large aircraft, let alone an air carrier. So I never forget, it was a military transport off of Andrews Air Force Base. Gopher 06 was the call sign. He was making a left turn off of Andrews, going right over top of Washington National Airport, just south of the southeast of the Pentagon, when American 77, a primary target on our scope, was acquired by the Dulles approach controller, who called over to me. And I forced the word look on the track just to get ground information on the guy. And right away, his airspeed started clicking off around 260 knots, fast but not outrageous. And I never forget, I said to the guy working the C-130, Steve Carlson, I was like, hey, you better call traffic on that guy because these two guys are head-to-head. And he says, traffic, 11 o'clock, see anybody out there? And the pilot came right back. He said, yes, sir, American 757 at a level turning southeastbound. And I never forget. I was like, what? How in the world did they get a Boeing 757? And I really didn't understand. Maybe I was just the slowest guy on the planet that morning, but I really didn't understand that was a hijacked aircraft until really it hit the Pentagon. And now I think somebody ran to the break room and looked at CNN and was like, oh my God. And now the news was starting to report, I believe, I don't know, I didn't see the news that day, that there was an issue in New York with air carriers. But once again, you know, where Boston Center knew they had two aircraft that were missing, Ben at the command center certainly knew that, and a lot of other things were trying to juggle big decisions there. And there was some sketchiness about American, was that a traditional aircraft or not? I'm convinced that if his call sign was something other than American 77, because American 77, American 11, kind of similar, and there was some miscommunication back and forth there. It was slow to get down to field facilities that were dealing with an additional hijack, because, I mean, by gosh, you already had two. And then it kind of went downhill from there. Yeah.
Okay, and Colin, when you were talking about the fact that you didn't necessarily see a need to show right up on the scene when they were hijacking, because in your experience, hijackings weren't very interesting.
usually you isolate the aircraft on frequency, and you isolate the fighters on frequency, and you sit back and you watch them follow them, and that's what they did with the Lufthansa, and it's a pretty boring event. And you have too many people standing around, they get in the way. You only have so much room around the radar scope, so you don't really want a lot of people around. So I never even got the opportunity to go down to the area, so I don't know how many people were really watching it. But I know it was after talking to a lot of my controller friends and ones that worked it, that it was a lot different than any other one they had ever worked before. So some screaming on the frequency and things like that were upsetting to the controllers, Peter Zaleski. A good friend of mine who I went to the academy with, the FA Academy with, and he still has problems with it today. So I worked in that position pretty much the whole day, and of course a lot of other events happened throughout the day, but that was the beginning of a long day with an overwhelming amount of information that I ended up receiving on the day.
So, okay. So as these attacks expanded, there's a hijacking, then a strike at the North Tower. At first, there's no connection, one and the same. The hijacking is the aircraft in the tower. And then you mentioned seeing 175 hit the South Tower. As the attacks expanded, a lot of air traffic control facilities made the decision to shut down operations. We had some airports where the managers decided that they were going to shut down air traffic control towers, evacuated. I know, Colin, your center was evacuated. How did these shutdowns affect all of your operations and how you were handling air traffic?
Well, I'll tackle that one first. As far as the airspace shut down for Washington, D.C. area, I got to give credit to Vic Pageant, made some great calls here. We didn't wait for a phone call from anyone. As soon as American 77 hit the Pentagon, it was obvious that, okay, no one's getting near Washington. Aircraft 5, 6, 7 mile final for Washington National turned away, get out of the airspace, anything within 60 miles, I think someone pulled that number out of somewhere, is considered hostile, get them on the ground. Guys on final from 20 miles west, get out of there, turn them around, get them away from the Washington area. We couldn't trust any crew. period. You didn't know what you were dealing with. And there was a concern as soon as we found out about United 93 was heading our general vicinity, and there's a lot of misinformation about that, but we knew he was coming, and we could track him on a TSD, which is a far-looking display. It looks at stuff all over the country. So we knew he was, I can't remember, 20 minutes away or something like that. And my operations manager made the call, the senior manager on duty that day, all right, get the tower cleared out. Get these guys out of there. We assure this thing is not going to hit, bother the airport. It's probably going to try to hit something downtown. We knew the Pentagon was burning from the perspective we had from our control tower. So we, for a very short time, maybe 30 minutes, set up a temporary control tower on the airfield for our personnel up there. But the TRACON itself, which is now very involved in trying to get the airborne assets off of Andrews Airborne to protect, we never stopped. Of course, I think we had a false sense of security because we were like two stories below sea level in a basement with a bunch of concrete all around. But
And you had tried to get word, Dan, to the tower to evacuate when that order came.
Yeah, it was crazy.
They weren't picking up their land.
Yeah, it was crazy because when American hit the Pentagon, I just unplugged from the position I was working. I was standing there talking to my friend Paul McCarthy, who was working the position. And when that happened, first thing I did, grabbed my ops manager, told him what was going on. He starts taking care of some calls at his level. We could not get through to the control tower because the phone's ringing off the hook. The tower CIC, Chris Stevenson, was in charge of the tower, and he had a phone in both ears. So I literally jumped on the elevator, which I got to say was a very uneasy feeling, getting on an elevator with my friend Joe Vangel. I was like, we got to see what's going on in the tower. We got to tell them to get out of the tower. And when I went up there and just saw the black smoke, it was incredible. The paper, all the stuff flying through the air was paper. It was crazy.
Because an American 77 had just impacted the Pentagon.
Just hit the Pentagon like 10 minutes earlier, about 10 minutes earlier. And then it was back down to the TRACON and organized everything else.
Okay. How did the shutdowns, I know you had heard of, was it New York Center that declared ATC zero? How did you respond to these shutdowns as they start to occur?
Well, we did what we could to assist the facilities. New York Center declared ATC zero, which means their ability to provide air traffic control services is nil. And so we, what we call to and through, no aircraft could take off to go through New York airspace or to New York airspace, meaning land in New York. And that was fairly easy to accomplish. And I have to say that any facility that did evacuate, I was not cognizant of any effect on the air traffic system to deal with what occurred thereafter. I am aware of one tower that evacuated that was ordered to return to the tower. I don't know. I don't remember what tower that was. I don't think it was national.
Because we never really stopped services. No, right. We were running continuously.
So there was no disruption in service from the command center's point of view. And in conjunction with the New York Center at that time, had an unspecified problem. They alluded to the fact that they were having a problem similar to New York, similar to Boston Center's problem, which we took to be another. But that happened rather rapidly. United 175, I think, from the time he turned off his transponder and deviated until the time he impacted was only about 11 or 12 minutes. In fact, all four impacts occur within 75 minutes or so. And all four were airborne before the first one struck the North Tower, before American 11 struck the North Tower. But the command center is in the business of regulating streams of aircraft. And what we did was ground stop, of course, obviously New York, obviously Boston, and then Washington Center, which encompasses the air that Dan is speaking of. We also stopped all LA-bound flights on the theory there was some nexus between the Los Angeles destination and these whoever these people were. We also saw all flights from Los Angeles, thinking that if there was anything coming the other way, we would obviate that possibility. But and then, of course, following United 175's crash into the South Tower, we ordered a national ground stop, which means that no more aircraft could join the air traffic system anywhere in the country. It was still early on the west, a lot of activity there, but it would have affected aircraft on the east coast and in the middle of the country. And then ultimately, when we gave the order to land at the nearest airport, regardless of destination, there was obviously no effect by any facilities that may have evacuated or not, because the air traffic control community and the aviation community, and I mean the pilots on the board those air carriers, and the and indeed the flight attendants on those flights too, to keep the people calm, those orders were executed flawlessly. And well, and as I'm sure, I'm not sure, the all pilots are in command of their aircraft, and there are certain things an air traffic controller can tell the pilot to do, but one of them is not where you're going to go, where you're going to land. We can tell them where you ought to go, and we can direct them there, but really that is a command decision for the cockpit. Yet, and I expected when the order went out to land at the nearest airport, regardless of their destination, that we would get a lot of pushback from the airline and or the pilots themselves. But of those over 4,500 aircraft, I got one request for an aircraft to land at an airport other than the nearest airport, which request I refused, because I didn't know if that captain was under duress at that time. And I figured if he doesn't go where he's told to go, then that would be a good indication he may be under duress. So it was a it was a horrible day for America, but for American aviation, I think it was a shining day. And I honestly don't think the aviation community got the thanks that they deserved from the American public. Not that the focus shouldn't have been on the first responders, because they were tremendous and deserve all the attention they did get and should get. But that was unprecedented in American history for the nation to shut down their air traffic control system and to put 4,556 planes at places where they weren't accustomed to be for the most part, and disrupt that whole aviation system, to shut down the borders north, south, east, and west, and direct those flights away from our country. That had never been happened before, and was not only executed flawlessly by the American air traffic and aviation community, but by the Canadians, by the Mexicans to the south, by the Asians to the west, and by the Europeans. So my hat is off to all of those communities for their very flawless execution of a bad situation on that day.
If I can just build on that, what I think is tough to fathom, 4,556 aircraft. Never in the history of airspace is all of a sudden they're all going to leave the airport. The pilots were very good to work with the controllers, but I mean the air traffic controllers, without a single loss of separation, put 4,500 aircraft on the ground in places that they weren't supposed to go. At the same time, the military is trying to get airborne and sort through the chaos. It's an incredible feat that what the air traffic controllers and the air traffic managers coordinating that stuff really did.
And just to give it to some perspective, I believe 700 landed within the first 10 minutes and 3,500 within the first hour.
Yeah,
and the balance in the second hour. It took about 2 hours to execute, to clear all of our skies and let the military. And our idea, of course, at the command center was kind of separate the wheat from the chaff. And everyone that we could control and get on the ground was obviously not someone we had to worry about being on the ground, and let the military fighters who were already scrambling from various bases and getting into the airspace, let them do their job and take care of whatever else might need to be done. And of course, United 93 that Colin alluded to, what I remember most about that aircraft is that as we were aware of the 30 minutes out from Washington and where approximately it was, we had a report from a small a private aircraft pilot who saw United jet waggling his wings. And that threw a lot of ambiguity into the equation, because that is a universal signal that the pilot has lost radio and is unable to communicate. And of course, it's not unheard of in these situations that a plane could lose their electrical systems or lose their avionics or their ability to communicate or even their compasses or their ability to navigate. So at late juncture, and that was only minutes before that aircraft struck the ground in Pennsylvania, we still were wondering whether it was truly hijacked. We never received any confirmation of hijack, which in my 50 years of aviation, I always had a confirmation of the hijack, either from the pilot himself or through a special transponder code that we know. And we had never experienced in our aviation history a situation where hijackers actually flew the plane, which created the biggest paradox for us on that day in trying to figure out what was going on, was how could a hijacker force a pilot, even by holding a gun or a knife to his or her head, force them to fly into a building. Pilots, and you all have heard stories of their actions, heroic actions, to avoid loss of life on the ground by directing a plane that could not fly to a position where it would cause the least amount of damage. And of course, in New York, we have the East River, the Hudson River, and the Atlantic Ocean. And in my mind, I could not fathom how they could force this pilot to hit that building, an area where I personally worked thousands of aircraft up and down those rivers, landing at LaGuardia, Kennedy, or Newark. It was just inconceivable to me and inconceivable to my staff, and I think to all air traffic controllers that would happen. But we learned to expand our minds about or our thoughts about these things based on 9/11, and I'm sure we won't be with that in that situation.
Colin, when I had talked with you when I was researching, you mentioned that when Boston Center at one point was considered a target, and I remember some of the staff there mentioned that it makes perfect sense if you're going to take out airliners to take out the air traffic control facilities so they can't even monitor and see, you know, what's happening out there in the airspace. And so at some point that morning, Boston Center was evacuated. And could you share with us? You didn't leave the building when that order first came out. Could you tell everybody about what was happening?
The evacuation at Boston Center. So there were a lot of things going on at different times. We originally had an unidentified aircraft south of Nantucket by about 80 miles, coming in at high speed, about 25,000 feet. Our assumption was a Coast Guard aircraft. That's where they come in from, Bermuda. And we eventually did get a hold of the aircraft, but for a while there, that was passing over the tell we were on, that there was an unidentified aircraft coming up southeast of Nantucket, which is probably about 170 miles from Boston Center. So we re-identified the aircraft, and we got him, and he landed Otis. And however, someone had taken those initial calls on the TRACON and determined that that possibly was another 757 on track to Boston Center. We found that out a couple weeks later. So we're getting calls from a regional office that our facility is going to be attacked by an aircraft, and they started evacuating it. And first, non-essential personnel, which actually I am when I'm upstairs in my office. I'm non-essential, but that day I was essential, so I was on the floor. But so they evacuated a lot of people. There was a tractor-trailer outside broken down on the highway. There was a concern that could have a bomb in it. Somehow that was interpreted that there was a bomb scare daycare center, which is located directly adjacent to the facility. They evacuated the daycare center. And so we're under a premise that we're going to get hit. And at some point in time, it was imminent, is what we were told. So each controller was trying to get the aircraft down for the national order to put all the aircraft down. They were told to leave. As soon as they got all the aircraft down in their sector, they were told to leave the building. And they did, and a lot of them hung in there and were doing exactly what they were told to do. And as each one did it, they left. And my responsibility still then, I was still in contact with Northeast Air Defense Command. I was still trying to get fighters into the sky or tell them where I think they should go based on other hijacked aircraft that we'd heard about that were not really hijacked. We had about 20 that day, 20 or 21 hijacked aircraft that we thought were potentially hijacked aircraft. So we're trying to still get fighters up in the air. In addition to that, I had to tell all our surrounding facilities that we're getting ready to vacate our building. And I remember talking to Montreal Center, and I talked to Toronto Center. I told them that we were evacuating. And I was shocked when I talked to these facilities, because if someone calls you on the phone line and says, hey, we're turning off our airspace, they'd be like, what? You know, what are you doing this for? So, but I was surprised how everyone was so agreeable to it when I called them. But I hadn't been watching TV. I hadn't seen any of that. Not sure of the entire implications, but everyone was like, oh, no problem. No more airplanes coming into you. And We understand your airspace is going, you know, you're turning off your airspace. And so that was it's pretty dramatic. Prior to that, the Pentagon being hit, I had a relative at the Pentagon. I was concerned for their life. I didn't know what happened. And so I had a lot of other emotions running through me, as well as when I heard the aircraft was going to impact. My wife worked next door, had a business next door to us. I'm like, well, 757 hits and maybe misses by 500 feet. It's going to smash into my wife's building where she works. So they were exiting, everyone was exiting, and got down to where it was just the operational manager, Terry Biggio, Ed DeLacy, and myself that were left in the building. And they told me to leave as well, and I was still trying to get all my phone calls in. And my last call went to Moncton Center, who did an unbelievable job that day landing aircraft into Halifax. And that was really amazing, some of the work that the Canadians did that day. And I finally called them, and I felt pretty much the whole day at that time. I thought I'd been very professional, and I'd done a pretty good job. I thought I did a good job. I didn't find out till a couple years later, which we'll probably discuss here, how well I did, because I didn't get to hear my conversations right away like a lot of other people. But that last call I made to Moncton Center was the first time my voice cracked that day. And I remember my voice cracking, and after I hung up with them, and I knew I had to vacate the building, I was kind of mad at myself because I heard tapes of crashes and things like that, and a lot of the times with professional pilots and stuff, you cannot be helped. Can't believe how professional they are in extreme cases. You have a plane going down with no engines, and they're sitting there talking like nothing's happening. And I wanted to be that way. So I kind of got mad at myself because my last call that day, I kind of lost it and started a little bit. And I remember that time that the building was built in 1963, Boston Center was, and since 1963, that building had always been occupied 24/7. So here was the first time, September 11, 2001, and the building won't have anybody in it. So I remembered up leaving. I went next door to where my wife worked. I talked to the general manager there, told him what I knew, that an imminent airplane was coming in. I'm waiting to see a plane come in the sky while I'm sitting there. And I told them that, you know, whatever he should do, they evacuated their building as well. And then we came back about 20 minutes later, got the all clear, and I was about the third person in the building as well. We'd gotten all our planes on the ground, with the exception of six military aircraft that were on a altitude reservation flight that someone had left them flying along, and they're on a speaker. We had them on speaker, and they're saying, is anybody there at Boston Center? So I remember picking up a handset, and I'm going, where are you at? And they go, we're about 60 miles from Westover, but we're talking to the tower. I said, that's really good if you're talking to the tower. I said, go right back over to Westover, and they'll clear you to land. And they go, okay, thank you very much. So the other thing to put a little light on it is that we had evacuated the building. There's a lot of terms we use with initials and stuff, and we have an FSDPS office. I have no idea what that stands for. But they were in the basement of the building, and there were three people down there, and that was the only room in the building that didn't have a speaker. And so they never evacuated. And one of those guys came upstairs, and he's looking in the control room, and there's, you can have up to 150 controllers in there at any one time, and the guy goes, there's nobody here. And so he goes back downstairs, and he says, there's nobody in the building. So like, and they couldn't understand it. And they're like, so they just went back inside, shut the door. So we thought we had evacuated the building. We did not. We actually left three people behind in the building.
Ben, you made reference to the fact that September 11th was your first day on the job as the National Operations Manager at the FAA's Command Center. When you described a few minutes ago how New York shut down its airspace and you stopped all takeoffs to Los Angeles, anything going to or from Los Angeles as you were trying to control or capture, minimize what was happening. And you talked about National Ground Stop when you stopped all aircraft from taking off. So 16 minutes, 17 minutes after you make that order to stop all takeoffs, is when the order comes out of the command center, when you tell them to land. What was your mindset? This is your first day on the job in this capacity. Had you received some order from the upper level saying do this? How did you come to the point to make that historic call that had never been done? And were you thinking perhaps that your first day on the job was going to be your last?
Certainly ran through my mind. After United 175 struck the South Tower, I had opened the line to headquarters and put a supervisor on that line, stood there the whole day with the phone to his ear, and I told him to ask them, tell them I'm thinking about issuing a national ground stop order, and they said they'd get back to me, but they did not. And so I think it was about 9, that was about 9:10, 9:12, something like that, and by 9:25 I just gave the order for the not any more takeoffs. There was really nothing else to do at that point except to land everyone. And I had considered, I considered giving a land order earlier. And since there was no one to gainsay me, I figured it's either the right thing to do. And by the way, I've told my colleagues, but I'm surrounded in an air traffic control facility like this with about 40 type R. chewing at my arms to get something done, and we were frequently conferring and exchanging information. So there was a lot of urgency by the individuals, and these two fellows would be no different, to do something positive. And we were reacting all that day. We kept reacting to news that we got, and finally, again, I was reacting to American 77, but it was kind of like the last straw, the aircraft that struck the Pentagon. And at that juncture, I figured we'd had enough. And it did run through my mind that, you know, if it was the wrong decision, because it would have been very costly to misplace all the parts of an airline and to get that system back functioning again, it would have been in the billions of dollars. But my only thought at that time was, well, I may be going back to my law practice sooner than I thought. It's not that bad being a lawyer, although an air traffic controller is a lot more exciting and interesting, and I enjoy that career. It did run through my mind, but only briefly. I had a tremendous staff that day, and a lot of people who will be willing to give me advice unsolicited. And I took that all in and tried to keep it going. We had people in the command center who voiced their concern over whether or not the facility was safe or not. And of course, it does seem a logical conclusion to try to take out a communications center, particularly one of this ilk. But the good thing about the command center is that I don't think anyone in the country knew where the hell we were. As they say we're in Washington, but we're actually out in Herndon, and we're in a private building, a regular business. So you wouldn't know we were there at all. Reassured the individuals that were making that inquiry about our anonymity, and they seemed assuaged by that. So,
Dan, in Washington, D.C., you were in a very unique position, being in our nation's capital. You've turned away all the aircraft. Nobody else is coming in, supposed to be coming into Washington, D.C. The order's gone out to land everybody.
Right.
Were dealing with the military, who had launched a combat air patrol over Washington, D.C. I think at one point you had like 16 fighters over Washington, D.C. At the same time this was going on, you were faced with an unusual circumstance because the continuity of government plan went into effect, which was a plan to evacuate our most senior government officials in the event of attack. And right. So you had aircraft coming in and going out. Some were talking, some weren't. How do you do that?
Well, I do have to be clear. One of about five or six individuals that really this, we all were close, we all worked together a long time, and we all just threw the rules out the window and decided, you know what? This is Bosco for a bunch of blank going on. Let's get a plan. And now you'll hear from Raisin, this next panel here, F-16s out of Andrews. He got some of his jets were already airborne, had come back, you know, pretty much bingo fuel or out of fuel, that were doing what they could. And somehow it was like, all right, I'm the one that was at the scope that decided, because he came off of my frequency by mistake, that was about the different radio frequencies and all that. And I guess we're going to figure this out. So I never forget, I said to Dan, I was like, listen, I got to be honest, I'm not an intercept guy, I'm not a defense controller. You know, civilian air traffic controllers try to keep airplanes apart. I need a real quick schooling here on what do you need from me? And, you know, Dan came right back. He was like, well, we need a common spot. We're going to call that bullseye. I said, okay, no-brainer, the DCA VORTAC, or VOR, right at the airport. Okay, we got that, and we need bearing and range distance from that spot. And meanwhile, he's setting up the fighter cap and we combat air patrol, and we're trying to determine a system. All these targets, because something I really can't get into in this setting, but these doomsday type of plans, continuity of government plans that different elements of the military and FAA practice every day to move the decision makers of Washington to a safe, undisclosed location. That all happened that day. It had been developed years and had been modified as things went on. But we never really, I don't think anybody ever thought that you're looking for an attack from the air. So now here are all these helicopters and various other things that are coming into the area to pick people up and fly them to safe locations. Meanwhile, Reagan and his guys are airborne armed, and we don't trust anybody. He had to trust me, I had to trust him, and that was about the extent of the trust besides the other pilots in his group. So how we didn't actually inadvertently shoot down one of our aircraft really is a testament to the DC National Guard guys and the active duty guys that came in on top on the cap, and the air traffic controllers that were just calling the shots, were calling the positions out to the aircraft, and they had to positively identify every single aircraft that came in. So the people that are coming in to scoop guys out of the Pentagon, the medevac, severely injured people to the hospital complexes around Washington. I mean, one of them, the major trauma center, is just north of the White House, and now we've got to get an aircraft to fly over to the White House to go there. The last thing you want to do. But we had to make our own rules up there, and was really pretty incredible. The decision for us at the Washington area to get everybody down on the ground was a quick one. Like I said, my supervisor, Vic Pageant, made the decision just on his own. Great decision that it was. And that part of our job was done. The big part was setting up the fighter cap and identifying all the other aircraft and things coming and going from the airspace. And it was really pretty an incredible few hours.
You had mentioned to me a couple years back, and the circumstance just kind of stuck with me. During this time, as you had all these fighters over the city, you all were breaking all the rules. You had invented your own rule set of how you were going to operate this day. And there was an aircraft coming into D.C. that had to descend into the airport, obviously a government aircraft. And you all determined how you were going to thread all these fighters circling over the city. And your supervisor walked into the room.
There's a couple of things. When the Attorney General was coming in, that's a different story. We'll get to that one if you have time. Ashcroft wanted a fighter cap or fighter defending there. That was so he didn't get shot down by accident. We didn't know who it was, but I don't know. The Andrews Air Force Base was recovering military leaders to go in there and do what they had to do. And the deputy manager, he was out of the building at the time of the event, rushed in there, and he will remain nameless, but he's very, very by-the-book type of guy. And he walks in there, as I'm telling his other controller, there's this Air Force jet at flight level 190 or 19,000 feet, and he has to get down to 2,000 feet to get and land at Andrews Air Force Base, and there's 10 aircraft out there chasing things down between them. And I said to the guy working him, Terry, I said, there are no rules, just to send through me, I'll miss you. And this guy looked at me like, and it walked out, because he knew. Which was a really good call, because he knew that he couldn't get involved in that. His place was really to be out of that room at the time. And he was good with that. And we had this conversation, the manager and I later, about what a good was. And I was calling the stuff out to Reagan. All right, bullseye 270-45 friendly, descending eastbound 190. And then he would tell the appropriate aircraft in the area, all right, this is a friendly, we're painting and we see them. It was really pretty crazy.
Colin, when we're talking about the military response and the fighters over D.C., I don't think many people realize that the FAA did not have compatible lines of communication with the military that day and with NORAD. In fact, when they attempted to communicate, they couldn't. And you didn't realize on that morning that the information that was going to the Northeast Air Defense Sector, who was coordinating our response for the northeastern part of the United States, you did not realize that you were the only one giving them information about what aircraft were targets, which were hijacked, where they were suspect. You didn't realize at the time that that's the role you were playing. How did you get in that spot where you're giving them the information, and how did it happen that you were the only one getting them the information?
When I went down to the floor, in addition that I was upstairs and I write the procedures, I also work with the military all the time. I have a lot of letter agreements with the military, write a lot of procedures for military airspace, and probably the one benefit I had over some of the other was that the Northeast Air Defense Command is located under Boston Center's airspace. So I probably dealt with them more than other facilities did, New York Center, Washington Center, Cleveland Center. They all deal with them, but not in the amount that I did. So when I went to the floor and sat down at that position, one advantage I had was the military has their own phone system, defense switching network, and I had their numbers memorized, the people that I knew I needed to talk to. I had the number for the battle cab. I had the number for the airspace manager. I had the number in my mind for the ID section, and I just had those memorized, so it was easy for me to dial into the telephone and call these people with what was going on. I had a lot of information coming in because in addition to that, they had started in, but I was listening in with one ear, and whenever anything passed over that, I would immediately call them. But it got to the point after probably 20 or 30 minutes that I didn't really want to call them all the time because my assumption was everybody was calling them and they were probably swamped with phone calls. And so I'd wait till I had some information and then I'd hem and haw for a minute. I said, I probably really need to call them. So they'd call them and give them more information. And they kept telling me to keep calling and give them all the information. But at certain times, I didn't want to bother them with that much. And a lot of the information I gave them, a lot of it was good information. Some of it was misinformation that was passed on to me through a telecon as well. So they did get a lot of good information from me. And I had a good relationship with these, with the Northeast Air Defense Command and a lot of the military units. Personally, I've met some of the pilots. I go to a range council meeting once a year, get to meet them there. I deal with their airspace officers who they... A pilot is normally fills that job, and probably a pilot who got in trouble, and they make him the airspace officer for a year. So I'm dealing with those type of pilots. They're not necessarily happy airspace officers, but that's their job. They do it for a year. So I met a lot of them personally, and I just had a good, good feeling calling them and talking to them, giving them the information. And I made numerous calls that day. In the 9/11 Commission. Question some of the things I did. A lot of things I did go outside of the protocol, as they call it, but we also complied with the protocol. But my steps that morning were more direct. And the protocol was a kind of circumvented process that goes through our region, through Washington, to the military, to NORAD, back down to NEADS. And I got a telephone number right here to NEADS. And like, why do I want to have all this happen when I can pick up a phone and call them myself? So I did. But in addition to that, like I requested to have them, take some fighters out of Atlantic City, and they're no longer a scramble base at the time, but I know at 9 a.m. every morning they fly out to Warning Area 107, there'll be a couple aircraft out there. So I asked them to try to divert them, see if they could divert them and come on over. So I did a lot of that throughout that day, trying to get them to come back. And The part of the problem was, since I made all my phone calls on that DSN switching, defense switching network, they're not recorded. They're recorded on the other end. They're recorded at Northeast Air Defense Command. So about 3 days after 9/11, they interviewed me in my office. They had me come down to the quality assurance office, and I said, we only have one call from you on a hotline. And I said, yeah, but I made like 40 phone calls. I said, well, I put them on the DSN phone. And I said, I know we don't record it, but NEADS does, and someone should request those tapes. And no one ever did. So two years go by, and I never got to hear myself. All the other controllers, they get to hear their statements. They get to hear what they did. So I had some problems and you know, dealing with it myself, because I never got to hear what I said. I thought I did a good job that day. I made a bunch of phone calls, but I couldn't quite remember, and I couldn't remember the order I made them in. And it would have sure nice to listen to my tapes to hear what I actually said and maybe get a better understanding of what I did on that day. And 2 years went by, and the 9/11 Commission was meeting, and they were starting to put their timeline together, and the timeline just up. And the military and the FAA kept having some issues. They couldn't seem to match it up. And somewhere, the Department of Justice decided to come out and start interviewing people that were involved in 9/11. And they came to interview me at Boston Center in September of 2003. And I remember coming into their meeting with them, and they said, well, we're going to interview you for about 5 minutes because you made one transmission. And I'm like, no, I made like 40 transmissions. And so our five-minute interview turned into about a three-hour interview. And a lot of things started setting up the timeline a lot differently, because those are my conversations with the military that no one had any copies of. They were out there. So they ended up going to Northeast Air Defense Command. They pulled the tapes, and they actually listened to the tapes for the first time. I was surprised they still had them, but NEADS never listened to those tapes either. And they pulled the tapes. They came back in January of 2004, and I finally got to hear my tapes. And closure or not, but I needed to hear those. And I remember going home that day and sitting out by my frozen pool up in New England with snow. And I sat there and I had a couple beers, and I finally got to sit back and I finally relaxed to see what I'd done that day.
You know, if it's not clear to the audience, what Colin did on that day was to actually get to scramble jets in defense of our country. There is only one person in Washington who has the ability on the FAA's side to request that the military scramble jets, and that's the hijack coordinator. They are still looking for him. But Colin took it upon himself to act and think outside the box and get the job done that day.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Ben, because one of the things that that I learned very early on when I was doing my research, the news had misrepresented the fact that you know, they didn't even know where the alert site was, and they're calling Atlantic City to get them to, you know, scramble, and Otis is our, you know, alert facility. And I knew from in talking to Colin that he knew very well who our alert facility was, but he also knew that Atlantic City had their training mission that they had every morning, that they were out flying, and that they might be closer, and that they might be able to get to New York City faster. And those phones that were being made happened very, very early on in the morning. And that was very noteworthy and kind of overlooked. Well, I don't want to steal the floor here, being the only one asking questions. And so at this time, we'd like to open up the floor to questions from the audience. And what I'd ask, we'd like to give the students here at the university the opportunity to ask questions first, and followed by any other members of our audience. Would ask that you only ask one question at a time, and if you have more than one question, if there are other people waiting, you'd ask their question first before you ask your second question. And so if you have any questions, just step to one of the mics here in the front of the room, and we'll let you see what. Can you go to the microphone here to ask your question?
I remember on that day, my dad works in downtown Dallas, and having no clue, was it 400 airplanes, when was it going to end? And do you know if your actions in bringing all of the planes to the ground might have prevented someone else from hijacking a fifth or a sixth airplane, or is there any way to tell?
I don't believe there's any evidence that I've read of. Maybe my colleagues know differently, but I don't know of any evidence indicated there were more aircraft. I did hear stories about some aircraft, they found box cutters in the overheads and things of that nature, but I don't know of any official report of that nature.
I will say that in some of the people that I talked to, some of the station managers of some of these air traffic control facilities, some of the other air crews that I had, one in particular, another American Airlines flight, that didn't get off the ground because of the no takeoff order. And the FBI had interviewed the crew. They had had a group of young Middle Eastern men in first class that morning, and they returned to the gate. And I know the FBI, I think, talked to the crew about 15 times, and that was briefly covered in the news, and then nothing else, no more was heard about that.
What was that, Dallas?
That was at JFK, I believe. At JFK. So it was a JFK, I think, Los Angeles flight that morning. It's hard to know. One of the things that was happening that morning that was very interesting is that these planes were being sent back to their gates. They were being offloaded, all these passengers, and quickly pushed out of these airports that were evacuating. And so even if, for example, that plane, that American flight, they said, well, didn't they stop those people and arrest them when they got back to the gate? I'm like, no, that airport was evacuating when that aircraft got back to the gate there at JFK, and those people were being hustled out of the airports and onto the streets as they were at airports across the country. So anybody that would have been there was quickly pushed out of the airports.
Lynn, in your book, you mentioned that there was an Operation Valiant Guardian that was programmed for that day. How much did that complicate things? They were expecting an exercise, which they could have misunderstood what the exercise was. It was a real thing rather than an exercise. How long did that take to complicate things or get it straightened out?
That was very interesting. And actually, based on my research, I think it was actually very fortuitous that Vigilant Guardian was going on that day, because what that meant is that all of the senior battle commanders at NORAD were in the battle cabs when in interviewing these commanders, they came to the realization that we were under attack fairly quickly and canceled the exercise. And so the net effect was there wasn't confusion other than for the first minute or two, is this real, is this not, is this part of the simulated exercise. It was very fortuitous that they were actually all in their command positions because of that exercise.
We had a couple times when I called that morning, the first things out of their mouth were, was it real world or exercise? And like Lynn said, after the first few minutes, it was, at least with the Northeast Air Defense Command, it was pretty much over with. And after talking with Colonel Marr, the commander over there at Northeast Air Defense Command, like Lynn also said, that they were probably more prepared on that day because they had extra people in due to the exercise.
At the Northeast Air Defense Sector, and it's interesting listening to the tapes, there's no doubt that at first, when the first call started coming in about a hijacked airliner, they're like, okay, the exercise is on, here we go. There's no doubt that it took them a while, and at one point, on one of the tapes, that there you could tell some of the people, they're responding as if it's real world, even at the very beginning when they're not shot. And at one point, you know, they hear of another hijacking or that it's crashed into the New York, you know, into the New York skyline and all. And at one point, one of the weapons controllers says to the guy next to him, if this is an exercise, this is one effed up exercise. You know, he's thinking, what twisted minds came up with this exercise? So.
I wanted to ask you, alluded to incoming flights from overseas, for instance, coming from Europe. And I'm going to guess that some coming inbound from Europe might have been diverted to Canada or so forth. But once, as you know, an airliner starts out over the pond and you have to consider point of no return and all of that, there had to have been some complications there. Was there anything particularly turned out to be a problem? Was it simple enough to, I mean, I know it wasn't simple. Was the remedy to try to divert as many of those to Canada as you could or possibly turn some of them back? But were there any glitches in that? And did somebody get close to running out on the way across the Atlantic?
Those routes across the Atlantic and any ocean are structured, and the requirements for the airline are that they have a certain amount of fuel in the event of an emergency, and there are cutoff points. They would have either gone back to Europe, or we have Greenland, and then, of course, the Canadian provinces all the way down. So I wasn't concerned about an aircraft getting to a place to land at all. I knew that our procedures in setting up the North Atlantic tracks, in this case, provide for that contingency.
The town of Gander up in Newfoundland, interesting story on that was they have 5,000 people, and 10,000 people landed that day on 9/11. So the town doubled in size, and the people in Gander took all these people in to their houses. I mean, it wasn't like they had enough schools to put them in or anything like that. So everyone was taking in 2 to 3 people into their own homes, and then they had to keep them there for 3 or 4 days. And they did sit on the ground for a long time in Gander. Some instances they spent 8 hours on the plane, but they didn't want to break the planes up. So they would find a certain part of a neighborhood and said, you get all the people from this airplane and divvy them up between the 20 houses or so. So when they had to pick them back up and, you know, let them go 4 days later, they knew where to find them all for their planes. So the town of Gander was amazing for what they did. Now, they did some land at Halifax as well as Moncton, but town of Gander took a lot of people in.
And recently, NBC, in conjunction with the Olympics, broadcast a documentary that celebrated the humanity shown by those residents in that area. It was a tremendous outpouring, and I'm sure all of us can see in our mind's eye the queues of aircraft sitting on the runway and the townspeople bringing these people into their homes. It was a tremendous, tremendous display on part of the Canadians. And I got the chance to thank them personally for that, and I know they asked, did you have any doubts about their ability to handle the air traffic? And, of course, that's a loaded question for air traffic controllers, and they handled it magnificently. They're not used to that type of volume, but they, so the aviation community, stepped up to the plate.
You know, that brings me, Ben, to one of the things you told me when we were working on the book was you said it was actually not so hard to take them all down, but it was hard to put it all back together again.
Yes.
And talking about the planes coming in from overseas, there was one Continental pilot that I had spoke to, and unfortunately my book is only on that day, so I can't really talk about some of the cool stuff that happened the day after or 3 days later. But there was a Continental flight, and when the flights were authorized to start taking off again and flying back to the United States, the flights that were diverted were the first ones authorized to then continue on to the United States. And it was a Gander for flight, this Continental flight, and I guess in Washington the command centers are determining, okay, we'll let the Gander flights, Continental, that flight can go, and then we'll do United, and they were given very specific takeoff slots. And you had to take off in that time or forget it. And so the crew scheduler at Continental Airlines called this captain. Captain, you are, you know, you're authorized. You've been cleared, you know, to launch out of Gander at, you know, 10:05 this morning. You have to be off by 10:20 a.m. And it was probably about 8 in the morning. And the captain says, well, given that I'm 90 miles from the airport and my crew and my passengers, to all 260 of them, by the way, are scattered all over Newfoundland, the 38 other aircraft blocking in my aircraft on the ramp there. And so the whole system was turned upside down and they had to work it backward, you know, to try to get everything out.
Yeah.
So
We often commented, it was easy to shut it all down, but real tough to get it going again. And as I told someone earlier today, the moment the last aircraft had landed on 9/11, the command center was inundated with requests to fly. And one I recall was the Texas Rangers here, not the baseball team. The Highway Patrol, the Rangers they're called, I believe,
Texas,
yeah. And they needed to fly a helicopter out to an accident site to get a person who was badly injured. Well, I lost my mic. Sorry about that, folks. But I looked at the specialist asking me to give permission for the helicopter to go get this person who was injured. And I thought to myself, how can I possibly say no? But I was terrified that anything that got airborne might get shot down. But I figured low-level helicopter Texas, go for it. And everyone was looking up in the Northeast at that time.
In the absence of communications between civil and military air on 9/11, or at least the difficulty of communicating between the two organizations, what are the lessons learned? What changes have been made since?
Just a little bit of it, and you probably finish off the question. I think what has to be said here is that how the FAA coordinates with NORAD now is completely different. I mean, the FAA has changed top how all that's done, decision makers in the loop. This domestic events network, every major air traffic facility in the nation is on a 24/7 conference call, so everyone knows what's going on. And there's all kinds of other stuff that we really can't get into that it's very impressive. One of the big frustrating things in my facility, and once again, it was a significantly important facility, only the airspace ever top of the White House, and I couldn't talk to NORAD directly. Our phone lines were all jammed up with everybody else calling to make sure their parents or their kids and everybody else okay. And at one point, it was just shocking. A speakerphone 65 feet away from me was the best thing we could do to talk to, like, the NORAD central switchboard. And it took them a couple of days to finally wire that line right into the control positions. But all that has changed now. And I don't really foresee a communication problem or a lack of information for decision makers in the loop problem ever again. The FAA and the DOT have done a really good job in that.
And just to amplify that, The domestic event that he's talking about is a telecommunications or a grouping of people, not only FAA facilities, but the military, the customs people are on there, Homeland Defense. Everyone is now co-located in a room if they're not connected telephonically. They're co-located in a special room in Washington, D.C., where this has been going on 24/7 since 9/11. So we've improved dramatically our ability to communicate. And, of course, the protocols have all changed. The protocols in the past were both for the aviation community, the pilots, and for air traffic controllers was one of cooperation and to try to prolong the situation, get them to land, exchange food or money or passengers, listen to their demands. But we knew from experience that the longer a hijack went on, the more likely it would be that it would end benignly. But all the protocols have changed now for dealing with hijacks.
Before I ask my question, I just want to acknowledge each of you for the heroes that you are and for the heroism that you exhibited by finding the focus. Your ability to find the focus to concentrate and execute your jobs with the level of perfection that nobody ever would have called on you to perform, and your ability also to show the ingenuity to step outside the box and just your ultimate commitment to the safety of lives and the safety of America was just remarkable. And we owe each of you an extreme debt of gratitude. Thank you very, very much. What I'd like to know is there must have been a moment for each of you at some point where you felt like you could say, I think the crisis is over. I think the immediate problem has been addressed, and there's some, and we maybe have a second to take a breath here. And I wonder what that moment was like for each of you, and what your first thought of what next, what now do I do, what that thought was.
Thank you for the question. For me, be honest with you, I wasn't comfortable until the next day. Pentagon was hit 9:37 a.m. Next thing I knew, it was 5 o'clock at night. The Washington area was under control. The fighter cap and the resources above the nation's capital are under control. At that point, Ben, I think there are still, for a variety of reasons, you know, a handful of aircraft that we didn't know the status of them. They're mostly overseas guys coming in. And once again, that was a whole different department. Of course, I drove home and got home And I was very comfortable that night. I was going to sleep well because I knew we were safe. But for me, it wasn't until the next day when everything was over.
It's never ended, in my mind. I don't look at an aircraft again. And I'm used to aircraft for my whole life. I'm used to seeing them in the New York area fly over constantly. And I seldom, if ever, turned my head to watch when I heard a plane go by, and I look at them all now. And I think it's all of America's perception of aviation and what's going on in those skies. Because long after the last, and on that day when the last aircraft landed, when we directed them all to land, that was some type of closure, but it really wasn't. There were, as Dan alluded to, there were, I recall a Japan Airlines flight that probably Lynn reached up in Alaska that nearly got itself shot down with a radio problem and not following the instructions of the air traffic controller. So we weren't sure that it was over when the last aircraft landed. And I think to this day, it's changed my perception of aviation and how I think about what's going on. I do feel it's up to every one of us to prevent this type of terrorism from happening again. And I think we've seen it demonstrated in the by stories in the press of passengers on planes overwhelming or a person who wanted to disrupt that flight and taking matters into their own hands, particularly with the enhanced airport procedures to prevent people from getting on a plane with anything more dangerous. I mean, you can't bring a bottle of water on board, so they've tightened considerably over the protocols they had in place on 9/11. But I don't think it's ever over, and I think it's up to all of us to keep our eyes and ears open. And, you know, as they say in New York, if you see something, say something.
My day, I started to feel more comfortable when all the aircraft were down out of Boston Center, which happened early. We were probably some of the East Coast centers probably got their aircraft down sooner than the West Coast did. And I started feeling better then. Then we had a lot of military coming off the ground, and I felt better. But I was still listening in on the telecons, and I remember, I don't know if it was Japan Air, but I'm listening to other parts of the country now deal with what was going on the telecon, and had a pilot that wanted to land Fairbanks, and we're hearing a conversation go on and on over this phone, and basically whoever the base commander was says, if you land here, you're going to get shot down. So the guy had to go. That was the way it was. And so the day went on for a long time. I got going about 8 o'clock, and that was the first time I saw anything on TV. I showered. I ate. I came back in again at about 11 or midnight and worked again for another 12, 14 hours the next day. And the next day, I felt a lot better. It was a lot easier. Even coming in at midnight, it was we watched a lot of fighters go up and intercept, but there was a lot more work to be done because there was a lot of coordination on helicopters and relief work trying to get down to the tower. And at that time, you know, people were still hoping they were going to pull hundreds of people out of the towers. And over the next few days, of course, people realized that they weren't going to hardly find any survivors at all. So, but to go with Ben, the whole system's changed. It's not the same as it used to be. It never will be. We have a lot more protocols, things, in place, you know, take care of what would happen today. So,
thank you.
I want to express my appreciation personally to all of you for doing your duty and doing it well, but Mr. Sliney especially for your timely and what evidently was a completely independent order to shut down U.S. airspace. I wanted to ask if you got any resistance to that from any other than the Texas Rangers, of course, but and especially if you got any flack for that later, since it was apparently an independent decision.
The short answer is no. I got no flack from that, but I'm reminded of the individual that I had open the line of communications to headquarters and. He called me over and said, "You're going to love this." I said, "What?" He said, "They want us to land everyone." So I looked at him. He said that, and they said, "Who did that?" And he said, "Ben Sliney, the NOM." And they demanded to know who gave me the authority to do that. Then they called back 20 minutes later and demanded to know why I hadn't done it sooner. But being an old hand at the government service, I wasn't even surprised over that turn of events.
question.
It could either help or hurt a person tremendously. I want to know how that changed the training for aviation, like, altogether in case of another emergency. Like, how prepared is the aviation team now compared to before the attacks of September 11th? Is there more training with the psychological state of each person in the aviation now, or did that not even occur? Like, did you just were able to separate yourself for the time and take care of the situation at hand before you dealt with the psychological issues?
I had you to the last bit there, but I think I got your question, but if not, please clarify it. As far as the training, air traffic controllers, traffic management, and ATC in general, once again, as Ben said, has changed completely on how we deal with hijacks, potential hijacks, and training involved. That used to be an annual refresher where you get like a 10-minute computer-based instruction thing. But all now that's a serious thing that we look at. And how it's handled is completely different.
My question was how, like, psychologically each individual can either break or at that point can completely take over and just, it's a fight or flight syndrome in the human. So, like, is there any more training with, like, psychological?
Not really. I mean, air traffic controllers are kind of a unique personality. I over for 20 years and we're all the same. Not really. There's a lot of type A personalities. I think we're willing to distrust the person sitting next to you. And as far as dealing with the emotional aspect, that's what outside of work's about. You know?
Try to get the crazy ones.
There are some differences. You have some controllers that are, I would say, very anal, but still very, you know, aggressive or whatever. They're mostly aggressive type of people. But I mean, I work in an office, and I have probably 12 stacks of paper stacked around me. I can barely see my computer monitor, and the controller next to me is totally spotless and gets upset if a piece of my paper even falls on his desk. So different types of people, but reality is we all like to be in control, and that's probably the biggest thing. And I think everyone's a little more aware now than they used to be and more responsive if something were to go wrong. Any emergency now is treated a lot differently than it used to be. It doesn't matter what the emergency is. It goes over the den to the domestic event network. So everyone in the country knows you got an emergency in Boston Center, even out in L.A., because everybody's listening in on this phone. But as far as psychologically, I don't think much has changed as far as the controllers go. There's no additional training or anything like that I'm aware of, but it's because the personalities haven't changed. They're the same as they've always been. So.
I think it speaks to that issue. When you look nationwide at the feat that was accomplished when these nearly 5,000 aircraft were landed without incident, and the controllers who were in New York and in Boston and in Washington when this was occurring, and the pilots in command of, you know, these, you know, 4,500 aircraft, I think their performance on that day demonstrates that their training was sufficient. I think the emotional load and the psychological consequences, I think for some of the pilots and controllers, there were some pilots and some controllers that never returned to work after 9/11. So there's no doubt that it took its toll on the psyche.
Thank you.
So, well, I think we're done for now with the questions. Join me in thanking this group of panelists. Take about a 15-minute break, and then we will return to hear from the pilots who were in the air that day.